Hello everyone. Hi, I welcome all of you to the channel of Wall Street Mojo. Friends, thank you for joining the session. Today we are going to learn a topic which is known as your long-term liabilities. Let's understand this topic in a detailed format. Now, as you can see from here, there is an extract that has been taken down here, which is your liability and the equity portion. And that extract shows us the details of the long-term liabilities, total liabilities, shareholders equity, and so on and so forth. So let's understand this. See, at the very beginning, what we need to understand is what are the long-term liabilities on the balance sheet. So the term liabilities in a company's balance sheet means a particular, you can say, means or particular amount which a company owes to someone, like individual institutions or companies. Or in other words, if a company borrows a certain amount that takes a credit for business operation, then the company has the obligation to repay it within a stipulated time frame. Okay, so based on the time frame, the long-term liabilities and the short-term liabilities are determined. Now, the long-term liabilities, which needs to repay for more than, let's say, 1 year, that is 12 months, they are known as your long-term liabilities on the balance sheet. And anything which is less than 1 year is called your short-term liabilities. Now, for example, the long-term liabilities, let's say if a company, there's a company called X Limited, which has borrowed a money of, let's say, $5 million. From a bank, we know that that has charging an interest rate, which is 5%. Per annum basis for, let's say, 8 months, then the debt would be treated as your, in this particular scenario, as the short-term liability. Okay, and if the tenure becomes more than 1 year, then it would come under the long-term liabilities on the balance sheet. So there are some list of long-term liabilities on the balance sheet which are as follow. The list of the shareholders' equity, which is the first and the foremost thing. The shareholders' capital, I'll write over here as one. This is the first list. See, shareholders are the real owners of the company. They can be classified into two categories, the preference share holders and the, I'll write PSH, and then there is equity shareholders. Preference shareholders are given the preference during the time of the distribution of the profit, and that gets divided if there is also a loss. Whereas, you know, the equity shareholder gets dividend only when there is a profit. On the other hand, if you see, equity shareholders have a voting right, okay, unlike the preference shareholders. So this, the initial capital or the seed financing required for the business basically comes from the shareholders' pockets, right? And the total capital amount can be divided into the number of shareholders based upon the contribution of the capital. And now the risk to reward ratio is as per the capital contribution for them should be analyzed. Like, for example, company A has been, let's say, funded by three investors, X, Y, and Z, with the capital of, let's say, I'll write X over here, is Y, and Z, with a capital of two grand, 3,000, and 5,000. Then the profit would share between 2:3:5, right? And there's a thing called reserves and surplus, which is another part of the shareholders' equity, which we, RNS, it includes all your profits, basically, and is another part of the shareholders' equity. If a company makes constant profits, then the pile of the profit at a given point of time would be termed as your RNS, reserves and surplus. Like, for example, if the business unit delivers a net profit after tax, after dividend distribution to the shareholders for the first 3 years, is, let's say, 11,000, 80,000, and 25,000, or let's say, sorry, 95,000. So your reserve balance will be standing at this three amounts, which is 1,86,000. So that this will be the total amount of the total reserve would be all this 11,80 plus 95, which is 1,86,000 for the third year financial year. The second portion, or the second thing, or the content, is the long-term borrowing. Now, long-term borrowings are an integral part of the business. The entire capital cannot be funded only from the shareholders' capital. I mean, generally, high capital intensive, like, you know, the airline companies, they are funded by the long-term debts. And to ensure smooth operation of the business unit, it takes a loan from the financial institutions or from any other banks or from the individual groups of individuals. So a loan which is repayable after, that is greater than 12 months, along with the interest, it is known as your long-term borrowings. Now, there are type of long-term borrowings like your bonds and debentures. Okay, the other than bonds, and borrowing can be made from the institutions of banks, which is also known as your, you can say, that term loan. Okay, so these are the type of the loans that you can borrow. The third content is the deferred tax liability. Now, tax liabilities can be termed as the tax which a company is obliged to pay in case of the profits are made. Okay. So when a company pays a lesser tax on a particular financial year, the amount should be repaid in a next financial year until the liability is treated as the deferred tax, which is repayable within the next financial year. Let's say, for example, let's say there is a company called 𝐋𝐢𝐚𝐢, which has made a profit of, let's say, 20,000 $1,000 in financial year 2017 and 18. And it has paid a tax of, let's say, $5,000, assuming that, you know, there is a 25% tax rate. But later the company realizes that the tax slab is closely to 28%. Then in that particular case, $600 has to be along with the next year's tax payment. Now, the fourth content is the long-term provision. Now, provisioning a certain amount generally means, you know, the allocation of certain expenses or losses or bad debts in respective of the future course of the action of the company. Now, the item is treated as loss until the loss is accounted for the company. Like, for example, like the pharmaceutical company, assume that, you know, there are certain laws regarding to the patent rights, all the research and development part is related, you know, with the approval of the patent of the medicines. Like, similarly, the lawsuits, in that particular scenario also, lawsuits, charges and fines from the pending investigation, you also have, you know, under the same head in the balance sheet example. And if a bank expresses a certain amount of a loan, which is not most likely to be covered, then the long-term amount would be treated as your bad debts. Okay, so these are the couple of things that are there on the long-term liability side, shareholders' equity, long-term debt, long-term liability, and so on and so forth. So what exactly is the importance of this, of the long-term liability in the balance sheet? See, the long-term liability in the balance sheet, they determine the integrity of the business. Remember this thing, integrity of the business. If the debt part becomes more than the equity, that is the D is greater than the E, then it's the reason to worry regarding the efficiency of the company and the business. So the long-term liability on the balance sheet needs to be controlled in the near future. Second, higher provisioning also indicates that, you know, higher losses, which are favorable factor for the company. So higher expenses causes shrinking profits. On the other hand, if a company assumes that a higher provision than the actual number, then we can term the companies as the defensive company. Defensive. Third, equity share capital along with the reserves and the debt determines the cash flow of the company. So purchase of the assets, new branches, and so on and so forth can be funded by the equity and the debt of the company. So that's it for the long-term liability. Thank you everyone for joining the session.